So this is the first commercially sold inductive hotend named INo Trident by Plasmics. Instead of using the most common resistive heating where we generate heat by passing an electric current through a resistive material, it uses an induction coil to modulate the electromagnetic field to achieve the same goal. It might sound complex, but it is literally like comparing an electric to an induction stove. The so-called electric method transfers the heat through a hot surface, while the induction method heats the plate steel object directly. This makes induction heating to be more efficient, precise and fast. Seeing the marketing that is usually overblown is one thing, but actually experiencing it gives a completely different perspective of how truly fast and precise this heating process is. And yes, this recording is not sped up. For reference, here is how fast the stock bamboo lab hotend is. This rapid and precise heating is achieved by a custom controller and only a slim metal tube that acts as a heat block. That also allows the hotend to cool down way faster even when compared to the ones which doesn't have that much thermal mass in the first place. Because this inductive hotend can change the printing temperature so fast, it would not only benefit when printing challenging models that have many fast and slow sections, but also do something exceptional. For example, it could quickly lower the temperature when printing on the supports without any gap to get a perfect bottom surface. We could also reduce the temperature for printing bridges to minimize the sagging. Well then, let's explore more. So to test all that, what could be a better way than to modify one of my most modified 3D printers? At first I just quickly connected all the parts to see if it would even work. This hotend requires its own control box and a custom clipper installation. But to my surprise, everything just went without a single issue. That meant it was time to order a properly made adapter from today's video sponsor, PCBWay. I chose 3D printing from aluminum as it is a perfect choice for a complex part like this. But because my smart ass forgot to properly adjust the tolerances for the screw holes, I had to improvise. Well, the grinding was the only improvised thing. All parts one by one fit perfectly in place and looked quite futuristic. With this setup, my biggest fear was that the magnetic field produced by the hotend might interfere with a BL touch probe, which could lead to a disaster when homing, but surprisingly it again just worked without a single issue. I know that a lot of people will be interested in seeing how well this hotend actually melts the filament, plus I need the data to adjust the print settings for the variable temperature tests, so I ran my lead adhesion test prints at 220 and 240 degrees Celsius. I'll be honest, I expected significantly better results, but its performance was more like a regular V6 hotend and quite far from the volcano numbers. But given that it was designed with engineering materials in mind that don't like to be printed fast with more cooling, its performance kinda makes sense. So let's make some test prints. I designed the first one with a variable temperature in mind and let it rip. For those who aren't familiar with the script, basically it adjusts the temperature based on how much plastic you dump through the hotend. In this case, we're printing in a vase mode, a simple vase model, and fun enough, you can even see a contour of a vase in a script. Comparing the print using fixed versus variable temperature, we can see a clear difference. Boosting the temperature in fast sections and lowering it in the slow ones gave an evenly shining surface, which also meant that the filament was properly heated no matter how fast or slow we printed. Meanwhile, with a fixed temperature, we even suffered from worse overhangs and sections where the filament wasn't properly heated. But this is an effortless test print even for hotends with common slow resistive heating, so I designed a true torture test that would only be possible with quick temperature changes. We have quite a few slow sections and those quickly transition to fast ones. Well, unfortunately due to low levels of smoothing used in the script, the rapid temperature change led to control board of the inductive hotend constantly error out. I tried less aggressive smoothing values and while it worked and provided a way better looking print, the increased smoothing also increased the print times. That is because the script also adjusts the printing speed to more gradual transition between temperature changes. I reported these findings to the Plasmics team and they started working on the fix. The hotend's controller was never intended for such rapid temperature changes, so it would be extremely unreasonable for me to critique it on this aspect. After a couple of weeks, they provided me with a beta firmware which fully fixed the crashing and allowed me to use the lowest smoothing levels. This reduced the overall print time and led to the best looking print so far. It even passed the hectic temperature changes when printing for the Benchy. However, this uneven filament heating at different flow rates can be negated with a longer melt zone or flow rate increasing nozzle designs. So a way more exciting possibility of this inductive hotend should be quickly lowering the temperature when printing on the supports without any gap. That should significantly reduce the bonding to the previous layers and produce the best looking bottom surfaces. At first I started with a very basic print just because here I had to manually edit the G-code and add temperature change commands. The usual way of printing supports is to leave a 0.2mm gap between the supports and the bottom layer so they wouldn't fully bond. However, this leads to prints having an ugly bottom surface because we're not squishing the filament to the previous layer but rather printing in midair. If we just eliminate that gap and print at regular temperature, supports would be impossible to remove. So the ideal way of printing them would be by lowering the hotend's temperature so that the extruded plastic wouldn't bond well to the supports and still be squished and not printed in midair. That led to almost flawless bottom surface even with minimal temperature tuning. As these results were extremely promising, I designed a more realistic bigger part that couldn't be printed any other way. The main concern with this specific print is that we only need to lower temperature on the supports and the pillars must be printed at higher temperatures to maintain their structural strength. So I printed in two different ways, one by lowering the temperature and eliminating the support gap and the second one by reducing the support gap to 0.1mm. Well then, the moment of truth. While the supports didn't just pop off when using the zero gap way and it required some force, we peeled extremely clean. And after a few blasts from a lighter, it looked like the best bottom surface I have ever seen. Meanwhile, when using a 0.1mm support gap and not lowering the printing temperature, I instantly realized that it would be impossible to remove supports without some tools. And even then, I struggled for a while to get them off. They bonded way too much and it would be a nightmare to remove them on more complex prints. However, the bottom surface looked surprisingly good. Well, until I compared the print with zero gap supports. It is hard to show the true difference on camera, so hopefully this lighting angle will help. Lowering the printing temperature and eliminating the support gap made a game-changing looking support surface. But could this lower temperature magic be also applied when printing bridges? To test that, I again had to add temperature change commands manually. It was a very tedious process, but it looked promising. Printing without changing and with changing temperature for the bridges unfortunately led to quite similar results, but as probably most of you expected, lowering temperature had a slight edge. However, bridges will never look good because just like before, we're printing in midair, and the longer the bridge, the more of these unbonded strands we will get. So from all these tests with inductive hotend, the one that stood out quite far was lowering the temperature when printing on zero gap supports. This is only possible with hotends that can rapidly reduce the printing temperature, but we also would need slicers that allow this type of control and unlock the true potential for specialty hotends like this induction one. So while currently it is not realistic to make prints with perfect bottom layers when using supports of a single material type, the future might be quite exciting with more advancement in this field. But what are your thoughts about all this? Do you think induction hotends are the future or just a gimmick? Or maybe you know more print use case scenarios for them. Feel free to leave a comment below. Huge thanks to all the Patreon and YouTube members for your continued support. Well, that's all from me, and I'll see you next time.